That's what I do during my day, is just try to help people find ways to move more and feel better. We're just from up the road, and I was born and raised here. We've got three parts. I mean, who's this dude telling you what to do? We've got why should you exercise, and most people know why, but I'm going to take you through the literature, which is not particularly sexy, but this literature is, I guarantee you. So I'll be your tour guide through some really deep sort of actual empirical data for all sorts of things that exercise can improve. And part three is, okay, what do we do with this? I'll give you some structures and hopefully change the way you approach these behaviors. I'm going to be dancing on and off the laptop so I can press the button, so bear with me. All right, so who's this guy? Henry Elliott. I was born in Sydney, but that's not my fault. I spent my entire life in Redland Bay, in Wellow. My grandparents live in Vicky Point. I live in Thornlands, so I'm local, and I really care about this area. I am an accredited exercise physiologist, which is a tremendously awful term. It's a mouthful. I wish it was exercise therapist, because that makes more sense and everyone knows what that is. What it means is my whole job and my four-year degree was helping people like you and myself try to be more active for their health. Exercise as a medicine. Doesn't mean I just shout at you to do more squats. I just ask you politely. And our whole thing is move more and feel better. And that comes from my journey through life with about 15 years of pretty serious crippling depression that is ongoing. Marty was talking this morning about sharing. Not trying to big note myself or anything. It's just that is my trouble that I bear. And on days when I don't move, it's pretty dark. And on days when I do move and exercise with others and I connect with people and be in my body and do something that's a bit more playful, those are the days where I flourish. Okay, so that's what I'm about. I'm about helping other people experience that. Part two, why should you exercise? I've already introduced this bit, so let's look at the science for a bit. Don't worry about reading all of the hard numbers. There's lots of little citations. There's over 50 references in this presentation. This is my job, is understanding the science of exercise. Don't think, okay, I've got to understand what the cohort was and what the p-values are here versus the odds ratios. I will give you the summary, and then if you really want to nerd out, I've printed the slides, and you can have a look later. Okay, so there's a lot of this. I'm demonstrating a point. If it gets overwhelming, just start throwing your popcorn and I'll move on, okay? So, cool quote. If exercise could be packed into a pill, it would be the single most widely prescribed and beneficial medicine in the nation. Yes, exercise is a medicine. So I realize that's a little bit of semantics, but it's actually a pretty important distinction. This isn't just me saying, weight loss. No, this is about flourishing, well-being, strength, vitality, curing illnesses such as diabetes, right? Serious stuff. Okay, so here's the literature. Pretty much most of them start with a title at the top. So regular exercisers, as in people who engaged in regular exercise, compared to those less active. That's pretty much the template for comparing all of these numbers. So for example, the people who were more active in this study, on this one, regular physical activity estimated to add around 4 years of life expectancy, so 5% more of your life if you regularly exercise. And those of you more mathematic might realize, hey, but an hour a day is 5% of my day, right? So it's a trade-off. Do you want to live longer or exercise? However, those who were more active, those years contained less disability and illness. So it's not just four more crappy years, it's four more years flourishing, to bring that word back again. Also, most of us will know that exercise up here reduces many major mortality risk factors, hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia, which is high cholesterol, coronary heart disease, strokes, even cancer. You can even reduce your risk of nearly all cancers by being physically active, except melanoma. It goes the other direction. But I think we can understand the mechanism there. So, makes you live longer, makes you live better. Pretty clear. And now we're going to hit that point home with about five or six more different large studies. And this type of study takes like 30,000 people and follows them over like 10 to 30 years. And then sees which ones trained and which or walked or ran or swam and sees which ones didn't. So again, those who exercise had 31 to 45% reduced risk of all-cause mortality, which is a fancy word for dying, right? From literally anything, that's all-cause mortality. Lived on average 5 years longer in a 46-year follow-up. So that's the same as the previous item, right? 4 to 5 more years life expectancy. Even in older adults, in an 18-year follow-up, approximately 50% lower odds of surviving that 18-year window if you were more physically active. Right? So we're looking pretty much half the risk of all-cause mortality in any given period, in any given population, if you're more active, slash 5 years life expectancy. And I could just curtains there, that's enough. Here's where we get into the more of the clinical aspect and the disease-y specific access, aspect. So we've got type 2 diabetes, which is the illness you do not want, according to most GPs. About 50% reduced risk of developing type 2 diabetes. And if you have it, 40% reduced risk of all-cause mortality from diabetes or cardiovascular disease. So half the risk of diabetes, almost half the risk of dying from diabetes if you're active. Again, that can just be curtains. That's the end of conversation. That's probably enough reason. And then we go here again. Alzheimer's, 38 to 59%, depending on the article you look at, depending on the cohort, are developing Alzheimer's. Again, curtains, that's a big deal. 40% reduced risk of developing colorectal cancers and increased survival if you exercised after diagnosis for colorectal cancers, which is very, very common in Australia. I know, it's a lot. Just let it wash over you. Take a couple of bits away that this stuff matters. Don't worry about the numbers. Prostate cancer. Lots of people get prostate cancer. In fact, I've heard from someone who would know that pretty much if you live long enough, you'll get it. It's just a matter of whether it impacts you, right? So a lot of people who have prostate cancer end up on ADT, which is androgen deprivation therapy, which is where they mute your testosterone. Unfortunately, testosterone protects your bones. So if someone takes your testosterone out, your bones go out with it. And you can lose 3 to 4% of your bone in 6 months. That is catastrophic, right? Exercise can reduce that to only 1%. So that's a quarter of the bone loss in that period of time. For reference, a postmenopausal woman loses 0.5% in a year. Okay? So that is, you know, 8 times, sometimes 10 times the rate of a postmenopausal female in 6 months. Then we have, it can significantly improve quality of life and disease-specific fatigue, right? Fatigue is a ubiquitous cancer symptom, and this is pretty much the only medicine that we have to improve the fatigue you get with the cancer experience. And whenever I talk to people who have prostate cancer, this is the only one they care about. They don't care about all this. They just want to know if I can fix this. And yes, it does. We don't know the mechanism. It's probably psychological as well as biological. Doesn't matter. That's a big deal. All right, anyone got a wife or a daughter? Because breast cancer is very common, 1 in 3 in Australia, and it's not just prostate cancer, right? This is all cancers. This is just having a little bit of a step into the female. Reduced risk of all-cause mortality if they exercise with breast cancer by 50%. And reduced breast cancer recurrence by almost 50%. So if you got breast cancer, got treatment, and then exercised after, almost half the risk of recurrence if you exercise in the ensuing 5 years. That's insane. Also, it can significantly improve quality of life, of course, well-being, of course, fatigue, physical function, all those things that make sense. But it also reduces the incidence and severity of any comorbid depression and anxiety. And if you've ever met someone who's going through cancer or gone through it yourself, it's pretty hard and it's pretty scary and it's difficult to do all the other things and it gets you down. Exercise can help with that. This is really complex, so I don't want to spend too much time on it, but there's a dose effect. So the more you do, the better benefit you get. Who's still with me? Hands up. Haha. Participant engagement. Hands were down. That's all right. Okay, this one's really complicated, but we were talking about it this morning. So BMI, this is a 10-minute conversation. I could have just had this one slide, so I'll try to truncate it. This article, which you can't unfortunately read, is looking at body fatness, adiposity, BMI, overweight, versus fitness and physical activity. Now, all of the research, this is just 3 articles, there's about 20 of these that show that it's fitness that determines mortality, not so much obesity and body fat. That has an impact in things like arthritis, this is body fatness, but for health, well-being, longevity, it's fitness that matters. So I'll read this bit out and you can just sort of go with me. I'll be your tour guide. So we have hazard ratio up here. So the higher this goes, the more likely people die during the study. So you don't want to be in this box. That means lots of death. Okay. Whereas these 3 boxes, that means you lived quite a long time. So this is normal body weight by BMI. This is overweight body weight by BMI. This is obese body weight by BMI. We still with me? Cool. Now, on the left, we have fittest 20%. On the right, we have unfittest 20%. So what? There's two things to take away from this. One, these people are all normal body weight. These people are fitter, these people are not. 2.5 times the risk of death, even if you're normal body weight. And then over here, if you're obese, if you're very heavy for body fat on BMI, you still have the same mortality plus about 1%, almost identical if you're fit. So fitness is completely protective as far as cardiovascular mortality, diabetic mortality, cancer, stroke, all of those things, if you're overweight. It's very hard to lose weight. It is not hard to go for a walk. That's why that is significant. Again, it is very hard to lose weight. It is not hard to go for a walk. That's why this matters. It is fitness that improves your life, not trying to lose weight. That's a big, heavy slide. I apologize for that one. This one's simple, don't worry. Exercise is now a frontline primary treatment for pain conditions, and like 60% of my job is helping people not have pain. Right? Because what stops you doing stuff if it hurts? Something hurts, you won't do it. So it's also primary frontline treatment for poor mental health and mental illness. So mental health and mental illness being two different things. One's about a condition, one's about trying to keep yourself going. Oh, and if you look at any allied health professional, as in podiatrists, psychologists, OTs, physiotherapists, chiropractors, anything, they're all telling you to go to exercise nowadays. Right? Even good doctors. In fact, there's a position statement released last year on cancer saying every member of the allied and primary health team must advocate for exercise at every point during treatment in Australia, which is pretty cool. That's how important this stuff is. All right, nearly done on the data, stick with me. Here's where it gets there's a little dip in the middle. We talk about mental illness, depression, and suicide, but this is a conversation days like today we should have. So regular exercises compared to those less active. Up to a third less risk of developing depression in your lifetime. Sounds good. And significantly reduces symptoms of depression if you have it, if you start exercising. Again, this isn't just some little thing of 20 people. This is 30,000 people followed across a lifetime, and there's two different studies there. This is big peer-reviewed articles. This is not just me pulling that out of my butt, because that would be much easier. Okay. Male suicide, this is just straight from lifeline.org. There's some stuff from the ABS. 3,000 suicides last year. Nope, 2015. That's awful. More than 8 deaths per day. It's male suicide rate, 3 times that of female suicide rate. In fact, 65,000 attempts. Right? That's in 2015, so that's dreadful. So this is a big conversation nationally at the moment, so I'm going to take you through some really big articles, and even if I just had this one, it'd be curtains on that conversation too. So this is physical activity and suicidal ideation, which means thinking about it, a systematic review and meta-analysis. They're big words. Systematic review means you look at all of the data on a topic with a very specific method, and then you produce a narrative from that, and it usually comes in the form of a sentence. But a meta-analysis means you pool every single participant from all the different cohorts into one big pool. So it gives you data, not just a narrative. That's the most powerful form of truth that humans have, is a systematic review and meta-analysis. That is scientific truth as we know it. Being physically active is associated with lower suicidal ideation. Complying with physical activity guidelines may confer a protective effect on suicidal risks. And that's pretty much how these things work. Someone spent 2, 3, 4 years with 10 other people across the world working on this, and it comes out as 2 sentences. Right? So this isn't just some flippant statement. This is enormously powerful. This gets a little messier. This is looking at a Japanese trial, looking at a few things that were associated with risk, and I've pulled some really interesting statements out here. So to do with, and this pretty much, they took a whole bunch of people and then asked them afterwards or watched their lives. It was like a cohort. Men and women with the highest level of social support, you talked about relationships before, had significantly decreased risk of suicide. And the numbers are, it's around half. Having 4 or more friends were associated with lower risk of suicide. Again, relationships. These findings suggest social support may be important for suicide prevention. These things are all very obvious, but when you see it in large populations, it's obvious and it means something. And finally, avoiding social isolation may decrease the incidence of suicide in men and women. Now, those all make sense, And in an exercise context, if you're exercising with people, you've got connection, friends, social support, and you're no longer isolated. I'm going to skip that one. They took some people hiking and they got happier. Right? Summary. Okay, you get it. I've just like washed you. I've attacked you with some data. And some of it was awesome. And some of it you went, what? Some of you went, that's not true. And some of it, hopefully, you'll have a look at my slides later because I condensed it into two pages. But that's pretty much like 50 years of, that's like 1% of the 50 years of exercise data. This stuff is endless. And I haven't even touched the happiness. There's an entire field of exercise and happiness and flourishment. Right? People who exercise are happier. There, I've summarized. Okay. Next thing. Okay, how? What do we do with that? All that mess. What do we do with that? So let's start with the physical activity guidelines in 2019. This is available online. Google it. Reduce or break up sitting time as much as possible. Of course, that's just movement. Move, exercise as much as you can. Some is better than none. That's the new thing in 2019. They added some is better than none. Previously, they were like, oh, if you don't do 10 minutes, it doesn't count. Some is better than none. 150 to 300 minutes per week. That's 2.5 to 5 hours of moderate intensity exercise per week. Recreational walking, swimming, cycling, kayaking, chasing your grandkids, pushing them in the pool, whatever it is you want to do, spread across most or all days of the week. So you don't have to just go out for 5 hours and do 6 park runs back to back, although that's a great way to get one dose in. And here's the critical one that no one in Australia does, and this is why we have such a high level of physical disability in our aging population. 2 to 3 sessions per week of resistance / strength training for muscular health. Huge. Not many people do it. Here's the data. 60% of Australians don't meet the guidelines and 90% don't do resistance training every week. Resistance meaning strength work with weights. So, my understanding of that is pretty much everything I've told you, if you ignored all the fancy numbers, you all knew. You knew if you talked to people, you'd be better off. You knew if you moved more, you'd probably be a little healthier, and you knew exercise was probably good for things that are metabolic conditions like diabetes. No one's surprised. So knowledge doesn't change behavior. That's the thing. Knowledge makes you know you should change behavior, right? And knowledge can make you guilty, which is an awful thing to have, but it doesn't change what you do. This is my favorite bit. So this dude, this is Ronnie Coleman. Ronnie Coleman is 8-time Mr. Olympia bodybuilder. He's got a documentary on Netflix. His body is destroyed now, and I'm not telling you you should do what he did. One-time philosopher. Everybody want to be a bodybuilder, ain't nobody want to lift no heavy-ass weights. That's what he said. Right? And that sounds like a very simple thing. But if you think, this dude doesn't like lifting weights. That's a big deal, right? He doesn't like lifting weights. What he likes from lifting weights is the outcome. He likes how he feels after. He likes who he talks to when he does it. He likes the music he listens to. He likes how strong he is afterwards. He likes that he doesn't have to worry about certain things in his life. If he had diabetes, he'd be stoked because he's managing his diabetes, right? It's not the weights. No one likes work. There's one thing everybody in this room has in common. They want to do less. Less work. Exercise is work. So he doesn't like lifting weights. So I don't expect you to like lifting weights. But we have to change our perspective on lifting weights. So it's not the weights themselves that you enjoy. People say, but I'm never going to like exercise, or I don't like exercise, or oh, I can't be bothered going in the sun. Yes, I don't like it either, and I have $100,000 of debt so I can do this job. Right? 4 years of degree, 3 years of my own company. I don't like exercise, but I love training with people. I love how I feel after. I love the music I listen to. I love engaging with others. That's how you change your perspective about this behavior. So I have 3 rules that I use. Find or create a context you enjoy, right? So I don't want to do cycling because I don't want to get hit by some crazy driver in Wynnum. I will die, and I'm terrified of that. But I love going into a room with people who want to do the same stuff as me, and they just want to play and have an hour of their day that's stupid, mucking around, lifting heavy stuff. So I've found a context I enjoy. I actually train with Tash, and I coach Tash sometime. Hi, Tash. Right, that's my context that I've found, and it's fun, and I love it, despite the fact I hate burpees, I hate deadlifts, I hate running, but I love my hour of play every day. So, If this is the weights, that's you lifting the kettlebell. That's boring, that's awful, that's hard. But what if you put some nice music around it? And then you put some nice people around it. And then you measure it so you know if you're getting better. And then you get professional advice so you know you're not wasting your time. And then you're actually learning some skills and you're learning about other people in the world. And then you're connecting that to a greater peace with other people and you're leading those in your community as well, right? And then it's not stupid, obfuscated nonsense, it's simple. Now you've created a context that's a big chocolatey eclair of deliciousness and not just that nugget of weightlifting, right? So that works. You just have to put some thought into it. Two, be your own parent. This is my favorite. I thought of this one because I'm a genius. No. Be your own parent. Not necessarily the parent you had. For example, my dad sucked. I don't want to be that guy. But I can create my own parent who is equal parts loving and firm when I need it. What does this mean? So on days when I'm really down, what's the thing I need? Exercise. What's the last thing I feel like? Exercise. All right, our parents aren't always around, but we can become one and go, Henry, come on, you know you're gonna feel better. Come on, we'll just do 1 minute. And you go, oh. And you talk to yourself, and this sounds ridiculous, having a conversation in your own head, but if you look at your own perspective, at your own situation, you go, whoop, what does that boy need? This works, and you don't have to actually have this little play in your brain, but if you actually treat yourself as someone you're responsible for helping, that's a Jordan Peterson quote, if you treat yourself as someone you're responsible for helping, you can make these decisions for you. You don't have to wait till you feel like training. You can go, no, you need to do it. Come on, let's go. And you can usher yourself out the door like this. Oh, Dad, and it works. I guarantee you it works half the time, which is more often than 0% of the time. Three, this is a little firm, but your health takes precedence, right? When you're older, and even if you're born with some disability or you've got some genetic stuff, your health is more important than how you feel at the time, right? Your health takes precedence. You don't get to negotiate your way out of behavior that improves your life and improves your well-being. You have to just take responsibility for these behaviors and just go and make it happen. Right? This is essentially, now that we've looked at the data and we're looking at 50% reduced risk of all-cause mortality across any given time frame, 40% reduced risk of depression, 40% reduced risk of common cancers, 40% reduced risk of Alzheimer's, I could go on. Your health takes precedence. And this isn't a guilt thing. This is a, well, I'm going to be my own parent because health's more important. I have this conversation about 2 or 3 times a week with men. I say, all right, here's your, just write me down your top 3 priorities. How much time do I have? 2.5 minutes. We're golden. And I say, okay, what are your top 3 priorities? 1, 2, 3. And they go, oh, family. Cool. What's your next one? Career. I was like, what's your career for? They go, money. What's your money for? Family. Cool. Cross off career. And they go, okay, what's next? Oh, being a good example for my kids. Cross it off. That's family. And every single thing for most of us ends up being family. I say, okay, now if I ask literally anyone else in your family, who's the most important person of your family? And they go, well, it's probably me. And I'm like, and who's taking care of that person? No one. People at the head of our families are always doing the giving because we get better at that. You need to make your own health a priority because you are a member of your family and you're a very important one. Okay, so health takes precedence. That's the third rule. Sorry to yell at you, I get a bit preachy there. Okay, it gets a bit more positive here, hooray. You don't have to change your world today, you don't have to suddenly become an Olympic cyclist, but if you don't change your world today, oh no, hang on, let's start that again. But your world won't change if you don't start today, right? So everyone's gonna exercise tomorrow, what are you doing this afternoon? I wrote that myself, do you like it? Very tidy, so clever. Self-kindness is something I'm practicing, as you can see, with all of these self-compliments. Start by simply going for a walk, stand up from a chair 20 times, or just go for a gentle swim. This doesn't have to be stuff that sucks. Just go do something nice. Drive down to Wynnum. There's a beautiful little pool in there. Right? Do something recreational. If you have some complex constraints, because a lot of us do, like the older we get, the more responsibilities we have and the more things we have to work around. If you have complex medical constraints, there are health professionals who have 4 years of training to help you understand what you need and what accommodations you need to make and how you can do it with less pain and more enjoyably, right? That's my whole job. That's my whole job. That's my whole life, is helping people, perhaps in your situation, access this medicine. Okay, things to Google if you want to play further. Australian Physical Activity Guidelines, just so you know how much. Right? Find an AEP near you, that's accredited exercise physiologist. If you Google that, you can just say, I live here, where's the nearest one? You can Google my company, because we're great. Or simply speak to your doctor slash GP. You can even get referrals to see us and Medicare will subsidize it for you if you are eligible. Well, I'm 2 seconds over. Okay, summary. Exercise makes us live longer, stronger, happier lives. The evidence shows that. That's not just me preaching. Exercise can keep us connected with others. Bang, relationships. Change your perspective if you want to change your behavior. Don't just change your knowledge. Change how you view yourself and your family to change your behavior. Find or create a context. Be your own parent. Your health takes precedence. That's it. Yay. Brilliant. Thank you.